Good evening, everyone, and a very, very warm welcome to the Frontline Club. My name is Vin Ray. I work for the BBC College of Journalism. And was that champagne cork? It's a good start to the evening. We're under fire already, Jeremy. This session is one of a series run by the College and the Frontline Club in which leading journalists look back on some seminal moments in their own careers, and in doing so, I hope, give us some insights into journalism and the role of journalism and the craft and their individual influences. The way the evening's going to go is we're going to have a bit of a conversation up here, and we're going to show some clips which we'll talk about. It's a format remarkably similar to Desert Island Discs. So I hope you enjoy it. Our guest this evening is one of the UK's most accomplished and experienced journalists. He joined the BBC as a trainee in 1984 and moved fairly quickly, I think, really, to his first foreign job, which was in Geneva, I think. And then as World Affairs correspondent, he has covered countless numbers of wars, earthquakes, famines, you name it, across, I think, more than 70 countries. In 1995, he was appointed the BBC's Middle East correspondent to work in Jerusalem. He then went through a spell on the breakfast news sofa for a couple of years, and thankfully, for those of us who enjoy his reporting, he gave up the sofa and went back on the road again. And he's currently in what I would think as one of the most difficult and exposed jobs in British journalism as the BBC's Middle East editor. He is, of course, Jeremy Bowen. Thank you very much for coming, Jeremy.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So take us from the beginning, Jeremy. You grew up in Wales, and when did you first know that you wanted to become a journalist?
Well, I think I pretty much always knew that I wanted to be a journalist, apart from wanting to be a footballer for a while and that sort of thing. I mean, the first realistic, I think I was interested in being a farmer for a while. But I wanted, my father was a journalist, my mother is a photographer, and she worked for newspapers to start off with, how she met my dad. And various other relations were in the news and TV business and so on. So it didn't seem like an outlandish thing to want to do. And I remember when the teacher, when I was at school, was going around the class, when I was about eight, saying, well, what do you boys, it was a boys' school, what do you boys want to do? And everyone said, footballer, footballer, astronaut, soldier, footballer, you know, as Apollo project was going on, a lot of people wanted to be astronauts. And they came to me and they said, foreign correspondent. And
I, to be honest, at the age of eight.
Yeah, and I had no real idea what that meant. Except that my mother had said to me, don't be a journalist, but if you have to be a journalist, be a foreign correspondent. So after that, that was it, really. I was always in, I mean, in my sort of late teens, I thought it would be nice to, actually it was a terrible mistake. I thought it would be nice to be a banker and make some serious money, and I should have stuck with that. But I didn't, because by now I'd be really quite wealthy. So with the exception of that sort of year or so when I thought I would try and escape my destiny, I always wanted to be a journalist.
So did you, when you were at college, did you do all that kind of student newspaper stuff and all that kind of thing?
Actually, I did zero, to be honest. I did zero. I think, I don't know, and I was always told it was a must if you wanted, especially if you wanted to get into the BBC as a trainee. And when I went for my interview, it was in the waiting room where all these people with huge albums full of cuttings, and they all knew each other. They're all from Oxford or Cambridge. I didn't go to either. And I just thought, oh, I just haven't got a chance here, wasn't I? Because I went down to the student newspaper when I started, and I didn't, it was such a cliquish thing. I just thought, I don't want to stay here. And I went off and went to the pub, I think. And so I spent most of my university career either going to the pub or hitchhiking up the motorway to see my girlfriend at the M1. And so, no, I didn't do much student journalism.
And you didn't do a journalism degree? Everybody these days seems to have to do a journalism postgraduate degree.
Well, I mean, back then they didn't really exist. Yeah. Well, there were a few, but so I did my first degree at University College London. I did history, and then I went to a graduate school, an American graduate school, which had also had a place in Italy. So I did a year in Italy and a year in Washington DC, doing international affairs. And while I was doing that, I applied for one of the BBC training courses, graduate trainee courses, and I, you know, and I got in. So that's how I got into the BBC.
Okay. I'm going to ask you to introduce this first remarkable, remarkable piece.
Well, what I didn't say about my application with the BBC is my father worked for it. And
the Daily Mail would have views on that these days.
He, my father was, my father, well, he's still around, but when, during, he's nearly 80 now, but in, during his working life, he worked in newspapers for quite a few years. Then when he was in his late 30s, he joined the BBC in Cardiff. And he, I think the fact he worked for the BBC helped me get an interview, but after that it was up to me. So I hope it wasn't purely nepotism. And anyway, when I was 6 years old, he disappeared off for a few days because quite near where we lived, in Abervan, a pit village, on the way on the road to Merthyr, I was grew up in Cardiff. There was a terrible disaster with many, many children killed. And my dad was went up there and reported on it. And actually, some years after that, when I was already a reporter, I heard the piece that he did that night. And it was, I think, it's great. It's radio.
Of the shattered school into the main hall, which is a mass of people and firemen and policemen, mothers, fathers, brothers and sisters and everybody, and standing once again on a pile of black slurry, and underneath us is the infant school. And on top of the slurry is a human chain, buckets, picks, and the debris is going away. Handful by handful, brick by brick, men are standing up to their knees in black water.
Sandwiches, something to eat.
Where are you from?
Tree Forest.
Salvation Army?
Yes.
How long have you been here, sir?
11:15 this morning.
It's about 12 hours.
Yeah.
Why are you digging?
My niece is under there.
Okay, love. Anybody want a sandwich?
Within a 50-yard radius of where I'm standing on this jagged, unexpected hill, lit by portable floodlights and light from miners wearing helmets, are working, I should say, about 450 people, men, women, and boys. They don't know where they're digging. All they know is that they've got to dig. There can be no supervision, no foreman. There can be nothing orderly about it. It's just up to individuals to do what they can.
It's a fantastic piece, actually.
Yeah, it goes on too,
I know, you saw the whole thing. Did he do a lot of reporting?
No, he spent most of his career, actually, as a program editor and as a BBC executive of different sorts. But he did, after he retired, he did some more broadcasting. He always did broadcasting. More arts and cultural stuff than that sort of thing. But I always remember him coming back with his trousers covered in muck and slurry. And obviously, you know, it was a big thing in South Wales when I was growing up, Abervan. And I had family in Merthyr. So we'd go up and you could see the tips. And you could see, and after the disaster, you could see the graves as well. And you know, my great uncle had many years before that had been a pupil at the school, and that whole and that's where I come. You know, my family come from Merthyr originally, so that whole South Wales industrial background is where I come from. So you know, I hear that, and it still strikes deep chords.
Yeah, I remember it as a kid. 144 people died in that slide. It's extraordinary. Was your dad pleased that you became a journalist?
Well, I think so, yeah, I think so.
Well, he might be now, but I...
It was very strange when I started, because he at that time, he'd retired, but he was doing a weekly current affairs programme for Radio Wales. He was presenting it. So when I went on my first few foreign trips, when I'd ring traffic, you know, BBC correspondents, they ring traffic, who direct all the phone calls and tell you, in those days anyway, they'd tell you who wanted you. And they say, well, there's a Radio Wales one. It's Gareth Bowen, Radio Wales. They want to interview you. So I had this weird thing where I'd been somewhere. I remember doing a famine in Ethiopia. And then I had to do a two-way with my father. That's a bit like when you have a driving lesson with your father. You know. And at the end of it, you know, he was very businesslike. He said, all right, we'll get straight down to it. At the very end, he said, bring your mother, bring your mother. It was recorded. It was a prereq.
So you joined the BBC in 1984.
Yes.
And what kind of stuff were you doing? I have to say, David Sells is in the audience here. We just saw him in the bar. And Jeremy just said to me on the way up here, do you know what? When I was a trainee, I totally wrecked one of his pieces, actually.
Yes, I was producing it, David. And you hopefully have forgotten. And it was quite... I was a young trainee. I had no idea... You know, Newsnight in those days, maybe it's still the case, it was put out with people by people with almost no experience at all. And the program editor was Mark Thompson, who went on to greater things. And I was a very inexperienced trainee, but I found myself doing some of the items on it, producing them. And David, who was a very senior correspondent on the program and in the BBC, was doing something, and he had the bad luck to work with me, and it was, the VT was in two pieces, and anyway, to put, I won't bore you with the details, except to say he'd gone all the way to Oxford to do this very good interview, which was in the second half, and the second half never made it, because it fell off the air, literally, and it was really all my fault, because I hadn't put in the right form, and so I always felt bad about that, David. I hope I apologized on the night, but I'd let me... continue to apologize.
I'll forget it one day.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So, 1987, you went to Geneva, I think, is that right? Which is, if you only joined in 1984 as a trainee, that's a pretty remarkable rise, actually, to a foreign correspondence job.
Well, I was a trainee for a couple of years, and then I had a job as a financial news reporter. And I wasn't at all interested in the world of money, but I was interested in being a broadcaster. But the Guinness scandal was a big story in the mid-80s for financial wrongdoing. And the home news editor said to me, try and do the story, and I worked really hard on it. And it went okay. So I managed to get a job abroad, yeah.
And what? Geneva is what, the United Nations, basically?
Yes, I mean, it's sort of very much the nursery slopes of being a foreign reporter, I'd say.
Not a hostile environment, exactly.
It's not a hostile environment, no. But it was quite good because it was a variety... The UN produced a lot of news, and I got sent off on a few breaking stories. And the UN also arranged for me to go to Ethiopia and to Africa a few times, and... so that was interesting, and I'd never done a job outside Europe at that point. And then the crucial thing actually happened to me when I was at the UN in Geneva, at this BBC correspondent there, was that the Channel 4 News offered me a job as a reporter. And that sort of hurried things up within the BBC, because I said to them, I'm going to take this job unless you offer me something a bit better. And what I really wanted to be was what was called then a reporter television news, a general news TV reporter. But I didn't have the guts to say, oh, that's what I wanted to do, because it seemed too big a leap. And I said, all right, how about if you offer me a job on Newsnight as a reporter? And the Newsnight, because I thought I had better chance than that, because I'd worked on it, but clearly the legacy of having screwed up David's piece a few years earlier still applied. And as a result of that, they refused my offer of employment. And but luckily, Chris Kramer, who was the boss at the time and went on to be head of CNN International, he gave me a job as a TV news reporter, which was at the time my dream job. And I was just 28, and I was amazed because I thought it would take me years and years to get it.
So who were the big beasts of the jungle that you looked up to at the time?
Well, in the world of television news at that particular time, the top people, top reporters were Keith Graves, Brian Hanrahan, Brian Barron, Martin Bell. Those were, I suppose, the main. You know, the guy who went on to work for Muhammad Al-Fayed. Michael Cole.
Yeah.
Michael Sullivan was another one. And these guys, they just seemed so old, so grown up, so experienced. They'd tell stories at the drop of a hat, quite frankly. They come out with all these things about Beirut or Vietnam or wherever, places which had happened when I was at school. I'm now slightly wary of that when I see. I was working with someone in New York last week who was born in 1986, I think. Something, extraordinary. The first time I checked into the Rashid Hotel in Baghdad, they had to send telexes saying with passport information and dates of birth and all that kind of thing to get a booking there. This was just before the 1991 Gulf War. And I noticed that the cameraman noticed that he was born in the 30s, the sound man was born in the 20s, and I was born in 1960. and he said, bloody hell, God, how these kids they have now. Now, I work with almost nobody older than me, and I haven't for a few years, which, since I'm only 49, I find it's amazing in a way.
What a young
industry. Well, I don't know what happened to the older people. Then I wrote, I'm the older people.
Let's be nostalgic for a while. Introduce this next clip.
Yes, well, there's three reporters here. I think they're all going to run together, aren't they, Vin?
Yeah.
Who I partly remembered when I was growing up, and partly I've always admired their work. Martin Bell, Brian Barron, and Brian Hanrahan. And Martin Bell, I remember in Northern Ireland when I was a kid, reporting from the streets, wearing some kind of weird anorak a lot of the time. Brian Barron seemed to go to much more glamorous places, and he only died a couple of weeks ago, very sadly, at a very young age of 69. And I was always in awe of Brian Barron. The last time I met him, I was in awe of him. I was always in awe of Brian. And Brian Hanrahan, who I still share an office with, among others. And when I was a trainee, the editor of Radio News played one of his, he was actually there for TV, but played one of his tapes and said, I wish we had this guy on radio because he writes so well. And this is a key thing he said, which I've always remembered. He said, listen to what he said, never more than one idea or fact in each sentence. Keep it simple, and listen to it. And he does write really, really well, Brian, in a great plain way, which is the best way to write, most direct way, I think.
Okay. It's coming.
This is the reality of Belfast today. Bombs in the city centre, so much disruption, so many explosions. From time to time you forget that it's become part of everyday life. And that really is one of the tragedies of it.
There were civilian casualties, people who had been caught in the crossfire of a tank battle, but overall Saigon escaped lightly. South Vietnamese attempts to block roads with lorries were a failure. These were simply brushed aside or set alight. By the end, South Vietnam's air superiority had disappeared. Any planes which lingered over Saigon were shot down by missiles. To no one's surprise, many troops in the Communist Expeditionary Force weren't sure of how to get to central Saigon. The people of the capital, now to be renamed Ho Chi Minh City, willingly guided their new masters.
This was our car. We started off the morning with the Union Jack. The Union Jack's still intact, but the car isn't. It was taken at gunpoint by a South Vietnamese army colonel, the man in charge of this sector of Saigon, and he was determined to die or to kill the North Vietnamese and communist troops who even now are advancing into Saigon. The car was a write-off because a North Vietnamese, a communist tank, ran right over it. This is all that's left.
I'm not allowed to say how many planes joined the raid, but I counted them all out, and I counted them all back. Their pilots were unhurt, cheerful, and jubilant, giving thumbs-up signs.
Fantastic. Brian Barron looks like he's on holiday, doesn't he?
He does, and that's a... Why can't we wear safari suits anymore? such a practical garment. I've always wanted to have one. One day they might come back in. But those three, I think they're three giants of TV news. And Martin Bell later on, I mean, it's a shame we missed his thing there from Northern Ireland, but he gave up actually committing his scripts to paper after, I think while he was in Northern Ireland he probably still did, but he said that when he went in the 80s, maybe in the mid 70s, to work in Washington, because of the time differences, he was in a bit of a hurry, and he stopped writing things down. So what he'd do is he'd say to the editor, put down, you know, 20 seconds of this and 15 seconds of that, and end on that big burst of music from the president's band or whatever. And then he'd pace up and down in the corridor, he'd pace up and down, and he'd shake the silver dollar he always carried in his pocket for good luck, and twitch his green socks, which he always wore for good luck. He didn't wear, in Washington, he didn't wear a white suit in those days. Though, of course, later on he did wear a white suit, and still does, I think, daily. And then he'd go and he'd pick up the microphone, and they'd press the record button, and he'd just come out with it. The first time I saw it, I asked him, actually, if I could sit in the air. God, what a fan I was. Oh, I asked him if I could sit in the edit room and watch him work, because I'd never seen anybody. I was, you know, fighting with my scripts, desperately trying to write it down, or then I got a computer and trying to write it on a laptop. And he would just walk up and down and concentrate and concentrate and come out with his perfect Martin Bellisms without writing. It was all out of his head. I mean, it was really a feat. Sometimes 40, 50 seconds without a fluff. And really nicely paced, because it was coming out of his head. He was looking at the monitor. He could see the pictures. And so he was hitting the right, and he'd pace it and pause it. And sometimes he'd have to redo it, but not all that often.
And the interesting thing is, if you ever saw one of Martin's scripts written down, it actually was nonsensical, really. But it was written beautifully. but purposely.
That's how you tell them.
Because it matched the pictures so yeah. Beautifully. Do you look back on that and think, that was the golden age?
Well, they all, people of that generation all said it was the golden age.
No, they still did.
And, you know, I remember working with cameramen who'd worked in, Brian worked a lot with a guy called Eric Thyra, who's still working in New York, who was a brilliant cameraman. He stayed on in Saigon with him after the Americans left. But others I met who'd worked in that era always said, oh, it was great. You know, we'd go up country for a week or so, a couple of weeks, then we'd ship the film to Hong Kong, and then we'd all go out and get drunk for a couple of days, and then we might go home or we might have another trip. And now, you know, with Five Live, News Channel, AM Bulls, and all the other terrible things we have to do, it's much more nonstop than it certainly was then. However, I think that the first half of my career, which I've had already, we've had some very good years, as a matter of fact, because what we've had in the time since I became a correspondent for the BBC is an extraordinary amount of stories, because about the time that I was starting out, the old post-war world was cracking up, and 89 was quite early on in it, and when the Berlin Wall came down, and so as a result there was the whole, everything that's followed that, an awful lot of upheaval, and that upheaval continues, I'm very glad to say.
Let's cast forward to 1991.
Yes.
And introduce this next clip from Baghdad.
Well, before the... I had had a bit of a falling out with one of my bosses at the BBC. And he no longer liked sending me on stories, which was a terrible thing for a young reporter and it had been going well for me for a couple of years. And this new guy had come in. He didn't like me at all. And I'd done a trip to Saudi Arabia just after the invasion of Kuwait in 1990, and he felt it hadn't gone well. So I was absolutely devastated to find out that I was not in the starting lineup for the beginning of the Gulf War in 1991. I was not there. As the foreign editor, who was my ally, said to me helpfully, well, you're on the substitutes bench. And I thought the substitutes bench will all be over, and I won't get anything, and it'll be, and I was in despair. And John Simpson actually said to me very helpfully in the corridor outside our office in the BBC, he said, my dear chap, if you don't have a good war, I suggest you leave the BBC and start elsewhere, because it'll be curtains for you here. Thanks, John, for that support. But luckily, thanks to John, I did have a good war in the end, because they sent me off when it started to the UN in New York, where I was number two to Keith Graves. And being number two to Keith Graves was no fun at all, because he did everything. And And so, luckily, though, for me, after a couple of days of activity in Baghdad after the war started, they were all kicked out, and John got back to Amman and collapsed. He had kidney stones. At the time, he was a vegetarian, and I think he was probably drinking too much whiskey. And anyway, so he was, he couldn't go back. So I still smile at the memory. One man's misfortune. He's helped me a lot over the years. I'm joking, of course. And no, I've got one of his items on here. But he couldn't go back in, so the foreign editor, John Marney, rang me and in New York and said, can you go to Baghdad? And I'd been there in the run-up a couple of times. And it took me a nanosecond to say, yes, yes. So I left, I was in the BBC office. I went straight back to the hotel. I just had a suit delivered, actually, because I got so bored in New York, I'd gone shopping. And they were having a sale at Bergdorf Goodman, and I bought this horrendous suit, and the only reason I bought it was because the shop assistant, who was a very nice-looking woman, with long painted red nails, whenever I put the jacket on, I said, how does this look? She said, that's great, and she'd dig her nails into the back of, and then she'd say, it needs a bit of taking in, and dig her nails into, and I was getting to like this. Of course, I had to buy the suit after that. I never wore it. I never, ever wore it. But I had time to pick it up from Bergdorf Goodman. I went to the airport. I got on the plane to London. I went home to my flat for half a day, picked up some stuff, and went to Amman. And after some shilly-shallying about, I made it to Baghdad. And the big test, I mean, it was all a big test, actually, because I wasn't as experienced at that point as I'd like to think I, at the time that I was. The big test was when I hadn't been there very long. The Americans bombed a shelter, the Amaria shelter, in the suburbs of Baghdad, quite a well-off middle-class suburb, and killed an awful lot of people. And so this is one of the pieces I did, I think, which I don't think I've really seen since then, actually.
Civil defense men have been working constantly since the attack. They were still pulling out bodies this morning.
Up till now, about 500, 600.
How many do you think are left inside?
A lot.
They said they hadn't found any dead military personnel. Soldiers, they said, were at the front line, not in the shelter. The sign at the entrance says Department of Civil Defense, Public Shelter 25. Inside, there is the sickly smell of burnt human flesh.
36 hours after the attack, it's still extremely hot here in the shelter. We're in what was obviously a dormitory. There are twisted and burnt bed frames around us. And behind me, rescue workers are taking out more charred bodies, many of them tiny bodies, obviously of children.
They said that some of the bodies were so badly damaged they were impossible to separate. Civil defense workers chanted God is great as they brought bodies out. The hole made by the direct hit can be seen clearly. The reinforced concrete contained the explosion, channeling its force through the dormitory. We were allowed complete freedom of movement in the shelter. There were no restrictions. We went on to the lower level. I wanted to see if there was any evidence that the shelter had been used as a military command bunker. I didn't find any.
That was a couple of days after the attack, because on the first day it seemed to be pretty straightforward that there'd been an attack. They killed an awful lot of people. We arrived there quite early on, and they were pulling out just bodies and bodies and bodies and bodies and bits of leg and bits of head. And I actually had a look at the bodies later too, because they went to they took them to a morgue in Baghdad, and it was one. It had a big lecture theater. You know, raked seating, and two or three, it was Department of Pathology or something, two or three slabs. But they have so many bodies that they've had them on the slabs, they had them on the floor, they had them on the seating, they had them in the hall going out, they had them in the yard on the floor, and they had them in a lorry backed up, which they couldn't unload because there was no space left. And they were women and children and old men, as far as one could see. Certainly no bits of uniforms. So I reported it in my first piece as that. And I was absolutely amazed when I was being interviewed live. It was the early days of rolling news, very early days. I was absolutely amazed when I had this interrogation from the presenter who said, is it a command post? That's what they're saying at the Ministry of Defense. I said, no. I could just report what I've seen with my own eyes and heard, and I saw no evidence of that, and I stuck to that formulation. And then I went back in to try and have a good look around to see, because you know, you're in a military place, you see an old boot or a helmet or sort of rations or guns. There was nothing like that. And actually, some years later, a British general who I met said to me, you know, by the way, you were right. You know, we had a lot of flack at the time. There was the headline in the Daily Star was Lord Haw-Haw reborn in Baghdad. So they compared me to William Joyce, the guy who was executed for treason after World War II for broadcasting from Berlin. I had a nice libel settlement out of that, as a matter of fact. It helped me buy a house. But so it, you can libel me anytime you like. It's fine. So it was. It was a big test. I chose it because for me it was a milestone. Because essentially, it was a big test, and I didn't screw it up. And I think that you know, in any reporter's career, you get various chances and opportunities and tests. And the key thing is not to screw them up and to try and do okay on it. And I think I did. The manager who didn't want to send me to Baghdad and had no option because everyone else was ill or committed elsewhere, at one point he came onto the sat phone and said, Jeremy, I just wanted to come on board and say that we have 300% confidence in you. I immediately suspected at that point that there was something bad going on because, you know, that is very unusual for someone to say something like that in the BBC. And Brent Sadler, who was working for ITN, in the Rashid Hotel, there was no electricity. So we'd walk up this internal staircase, which was without light. So you have these little lights from mag lights, and he loomed up with his little torch, you know. He loomed up next to me and said, Jeremy, I hear there's a big row about your reporting. I hear it's gone right to the board of management of the BBC. They're saying that it's all wrong. I said, first I've heard of it, Brent. Because it was. No one at the BBC had told me, actually. But obviously the guys at ITN had told him with some glee. he was very tough to work against, actually, because I always felt that Arguably was a much better writer than him, but he was hyperactive and very difficult to. I never think you should try and second guess the opposition. You should try and just do your own thing, but you know, I was always worried that he was up to something, because he normally was.
The pressure on you was really acute. I remember this very well. In fact, you didn't say that. I thought you were going to mention the Sun headline, which was the Baghdad Broadcasting Corporation.
Oh, yeah, that too, yes. The Express.
Yes. One of the things, I saw this piece in a different context recently, and the piece, it was filmed by Rory Peck, I think.
Yes, it was, yeah, one of the founders of Frontline News, of course.
And there were pictures of pieces of body, which I'm not entirely convinced we would show today. And I just wonder what you felt. There's been this ongoing argument about how much distressing imagery we should use. And Martin Bell has said quite a lot, you know, we show the tanks and the mortars firing from the hills, but we never actually show what it really does in the city below. Editors will say, actually, people just turn off if you do. What do you think, Jeremy? Where do you sit in all that?
I'm with Martin. I think we sanitize too much. I actually, Vin, funnily enough, I think we sanitize less than we did. I mean, I went in 91, I went to a cyclone in Bangladesh. And this cyclone, well, I only went because 120,000 people died. When it was only 50,000, they still weren't sending me. I'd ring up, and each day I wanted to go, and the death toll started off at about 10,000. So I said to the foreign desk, come on, 10,000 dead, we should go. He said, no, I don't think so. And 40,000, 50, no. And then I was going off to do something else in Italy, and I was driving to the airport, and I turned on the Today program, and it said 120,000 dead, latest estimates in Bangladesh, and I thought, we're definitely going to go. So I rang up the foreign editor, he said, where have you been? You've got to go to Bangladesh. I said, I've been trying to go there the last 3 days, for Christ's sake. So, but I went there, and in all the reporting I did, they didn't let me show one body. And the only reason I was there was because 120,000 people were dead, which is if you think about it, is nuts. And it's even more nuts in a war. Now, in that thing, that day and that morning in Baghdad, after we were at the first morning when it happened, after we were at the shelter, we went over to a hospital. There were one or two wounded. There weren't many survivors because of the force inside the shelter was so extreme. But in the yard outside, they laid out pieces of body, and it was a bit of a photo opportunity. And so I said to Rory, you know, please film it in a tasteful way, because otherwise it's not going to get on, you know. And the usual thing you do in that situation is close-ups of hands or of feet or toes, that sort of thing. Bit of hair, maybe. Maybe not hair. And then he did that. Then I saw him getting big close-ups of, you know, thighs, and it was like a butcher shop, you know, chests blown to bits and blood and guts. And I said, Rory, it's never going to get on. He said, I know it's not going to get on, but I'm going to want to feed it. So those people back in London realize what it's really like. And it's a big, I've had these discussions so many times with program editors who are worried that, I mean, I'm a father now myself, so I certainly would let my kids watch the news with all that stuff on it.
You wouldn't? But
no, not with all that. And I think it should be on later. No, my kids don't watch the news. No way. I mean, especially not if I'm on it. I don't want them to be worried about what I'm up to. And so I think after 10 is fine, but you've got to, I appreciate the argument that you show it too often, people get inured to it. I really think they do. But there are times when you've got to give it to them with both barrels. And we get criticism in the Middle East, for example, where I work a lot, because of the fact we don't show everything. Say in our coverage of Gaza this year, Al Jazeera and some of the other Arabic language, Arabia and some of the others, all of the others, would show, they don't just show everything, they show it more than once. And then they slow-mo it and put it in promotions and things like that, and we have a different approach. Now, I think they go too far, and I think that we don't go far enough. And of course, the argument there is very much, if you don't show all of it, you're covering it up. You're being dishonest. So I've many times in Gaza had Palestinians and others saying to me, you're covering it up, you're not showing all of it, those who'd seen it on the BBC World. And we're not covering anything up, but we do, I think, sometimes over-sanitize in the interests of somehow sparing our viewers. And that point that Martin Bell makes about seeing people blazing away and not seeing the consequences, it reduces it to being a Wild West show,
yeah,
or a cop show.
So you would do more, but you'd use the notional watershed.
I'd use the watershed, and I wouldn't do it all the time.
Yeah.
You know, you could report on a road traffic accident and with one dead in Wiltshire and have most horrific pictures if you wanted. Obviously, that wouldn't be appropriate. But I think that if the story is a whole lot of kids are being killed, let's see some dead kids, because it's really a shocking sight. I've seen it many times. It's a shocking sight. I've filmed it many times and not often been able to use it. But I think we do push it a bit more than we did, actually, funnily enough now.
In terms of seminal moments in journalism, the first Gulf War was a really seminal moment because it was when CNN really came of age.
Yeah.
Were you aware of that at the time, and was that painful for you?
I was so aware of it because in Baghdad in the Rashid Hotel, we were really bad odor with the Iraqis. CNN were like that with the Iraqis. And they were allowed to bring in a satellite uplink, which was a very, very new piece of technology in those days. And their man, Peter Arnett, who for that year and a few years afterwards was the most famous journalist in the world, bar none, was live the whole time, the whole time. Christine Amanpour was there too as his kind of number two, but she didn't do a great deal because Peter did everything. And he deserved his moment. He'd paid his dues, you know. He'd been in Vietnam for many years, he'd been with the AP, he'd done all sorts of things. So he was a proper journalist, very proper. But he was there in front of the camera, and he was the voice of the Gulf War, really, in many ways. And we were way, way behind it because we didn't have the technology. Then we were able to use someone else's uplink, and then the Iraqis wouldn't let us. I remember them coming in and knocking the lights over to stop us broadcasting because they said that we were sending signals to the Allied planes when 20 yards over the other side of the garden, Peter Arnett was four lights were on him and a massive uplink had been broadcasting constantly at that point for about 3 weeks. So they knew he was. But no, it was CNN's war, and they rewrote the book about how you do journalism and TV journalism, and we've all copied it. I'd like to think we're a bit better at it than they are now, but it was, they did it. They saw how the technology would change things more quickly than anybody else, and they were on it more quickly, and they had some really good people working for them who planned it all in advance. This is how we're going to cover this war. And they did it brilliantly, and we were left trailing, floundering in their wake.
Let's introduce your next piece,
Jeff. Yes. The next piece, yes, this is the former Yugoslavia preoccupied me enormously from 1991 really to 1999, and especially from 92 to 95, which was the siege of Sarajevo and the war in Bosnia. And in the course of that, I heard from the UNHCR that I was in Sarajevo. I heard that the city of Mostar, the second city, essentially, was besieged. And I knew that, but the UNHCR said that there was this, as they put it, a Ho Chi Minh trail, a trail over the mountains to go into the besieged Muslim, eastern side, mainly Muslim, eastern side of Mostar, Bosnian government supporting. And so it's a journey which now, if you drive from Sarajevo to Mostar, it takes 40 minutes maximum, probably. It took us 3 days, not including the time it took to get taking permissions. And it culminated with about a 15-hour walk over the mountains with the Bosnian army resupply convoy going along this trail to get into East Mostar. With they had a caravan of about 20 or 25 pack horses with wooden saddles. It was amazing seeing them saddling up. It was like something from the Spanish Civil War, with these hairy mountain men, these stout little horses, wooden saddles, all of them loaded with ammo, except for three that we'd rented for Deutschmarks, which had our massive sat foam, which in those days was, you know, like that, and flak jackets and gear and tripods and all this kind of stuff. And then we walked in we had some adventures along the way, got shot at. We had a bloke who was showing us where to go in case we got separated from the others. He said, walk quickly here because they can see the trail and you get shot at. I was really dehydrated, and I saw these lovely succulent blackberries on a bush. So as I slowed down a bit, and I was picking the blackberries, stuffing them into my mouth. And then this machine gun started firing, and you know, it was like a film again. Bullets were coming, you know, popping through the dirt just next to me. So I threw myself into the blackberry bush. The cameraman threw himself behind a tree. Someone else was hiding. And I thought to myself at the time, how ridiculous, getting killed for blackberries. But as you say, it didn't happen. That we were stuck there for a while, and I ate the blackberries, and I had a little sleep actually in the blackberry bush, and then we carried on. And then the last bit, they loaded all the ammo into a truck, and then us and the accompanying soldiers had to sit on the truck, on the ammo, on the boxes of mortar bombs and tracer bullets, and we drove in through the front, and again it was quite hairy with lots of bullets flying around, and I just thought, we're on this, you know, if one bullet hits this, we're just going to be vaporized. But by that point, we were too tired. We didn't care. You know, we'd been walking all day. Been a three-day trip. And we got to Mostar, and Mostar was an incredible, so it was a hell of a story. And I did a lot of reporting from there. Then I went to do a documentary immediately after that. And this is the beginning of it, I believe.
Well, Jeremy hasn't said, I was foreign editor at the time, and I remember the expense claim for the three donkeys, actually, which I'd like to know where they are now.
There are no safe places in East Mostar. You can be killed or maimed at any time on any street corner. Until you see it happening, it's hard to realize how quickly lives can be destroyed. Franjo Pavlovich, who was born a Croat, made the mistake of going out to repair some shell damage on what had started out as a quiet morning. Because Raima, his wife, is a Muslim, the Croats expelled them over the front line into East Mostar in August. He had one chance. A fire engine, the only one left on this side of Mostar, was nearby. Perhaps it could get him to the hospital in time. Nothing in her life before the war had prepared Mrs. Pavlovich for this. She's 53. After they married, she worked as an accountant in a graphic design business. The last traces of that life disappeared when her husband was hit. The streets were empty, and not just because of the shelling. There's a six-hour-long daytime curfew. The idea is to stop people getting hurt. The hospital was only a few minutes away. Nothing is more than a few minutes away in East Mostar. The doctor hardly had to look at him. Mr. Pavlovich was dead. He'd been killed by shrapnel in the chest. For her sake, he went through the motions.
Incredibly powerful piece.
I was very passionate about what was happening in Yugoslavia, and it's slightly former Yugoslavia, and it challenged my BBC rules about impartiality, actually, because, you know, it seemed to me to be such a terrible injustice that was being done to people there, and I found it quite hard at times not to say that in my stories, but I felt that actually the stories I did reflected that. Because if you did the story correctly and reflected the truth, which is after all what we're meant to be doing, then the truth would come out. And I hope in things like that that it did, that there were civilians who were caught up in it, who were being shelled for different reasons in different places and different times. And I've testified twice at the War Crimes Tribunal in The Hague, and I'm going to do it again, actually, with Karadzic, when his trial starts.
Have you been criticised for that?
Well, some not me directly, but some reporters say they, or journalists say they won't testify because somehow it breaks the compact with your sources. Or I think if what you're talking about is when I've been at the War Crimes Tribunal is what I've reported on. And the state of the civilians. They haven't got me there saying, well, I had a secret conversation with somebody. They've actually got me there saying, well, what was it like to be a civilian in Sarajevo? What was it like to be a civilian in Mostar? I mean, that documentary has, which was a 45 or 50 minute documentary, that was the beginning of it, has been admitted twice, actually, as evidence. And I hope it helped put them away. There's some people serving 25 year sentences, Bosnian Croats, who were perpetrating that stuff. And that was one of the things, you know, in long trials, one of the pieces of evidence that helped put them in prison. And I'm glad that it did, because I think they deserved it.
Talk about safety a minute, because that was 1993, yes. I think. BBC introduced flak jackets and armored vehicles in 92 Sarajevo. And then in 93, John Schofield was killed in Croatia. And yes. This whole kind of safety industry began to emerge. What are your own personal kind of habits and rules for survival in a danger zone?
Well, I don't do the dangerous stuff I did now, but I always felt I was reasonably cautious, but looking back on it, I was extraordinarily uncautious. When I first went to a war, which was El Salvador in 1989, we didn't have flak jackets. We didn't have any kind of safety training, no first aid training, no gear. I was working in Washington at the time, and I thought, well, what should I take? So I took my running shoes, because I thought I'd be doing a lot of running. And then we still didn't have flak jackets. And in 91, in the Croatian war, I was I was heading out to Belgrade to try to go to the Serb side in the war and between the Serbs and Croats. And I was asked to take this very really heavy package for the Reuters guys. And they said it was just something they needed. And they weren't there. And I got back to the hotel, I thought, I'll just take a look at this, I wonder what it is. And I opened it up, and it was the first time I'd ever seen flak jackets of the kind which are now very familiar to people who watch TV and see reporters. Only the problem was, I thought, right, I'm going to borrow this, I'll wear it. The problem was they'd only come with one plate. So you thought to yourself, I thought, this couldn't be right. Because normally they have a plate fore and aft. So I thought, well, do I put it in the front or do I put it in the back? Would I be facing it or would I be running away from it? I think I put it in the back. I assumed I'd be running away from it. So there is now a big safety thing. There's a big culture of safety in the BBC, which is, I think, necessary, but at times a little bit theoretical. Because there is no way of going to a war and covering it effectively as a reporter without taking really serious risks with your life. Otherwise, you just can't do it. And there'll always be young people who, like I was at the time, felt that I was indestructible, who were prepared to take, I was prepared to take the risks. And touch wood, you know, nothing bad happened to me, but terrible things happened to an awful lot of my friends. And Rory Peck, who I worked with in Baghdad, was a couple of years after that, he was shot in the attempted coup in Moscow in 93 and was killed. Numbers of other people. So there's no way of doing it safely. There are ways of trying to minimize the risk. But actually, if you've been in these situations enough, you realize that if you're in the wrong place at the wrong time, it takes that long and you're dead or very badly hurt. And I had a lot of narrow escapes, and luckily though, I never, apart from falling through a glass table in Sarajevo when I was drunk, when I had this terrible gash on my hand, and I remember thinking, I'm going to bleed to death. And this is a humiliating way to die. But actually, I was fine. And I slipped over once in Grozny, at the time when that picture was taken, when they were completely flattening the center of Grozny. And we actually had a view over that area from this tower build block, which had half, the whole side of it had been blown off. We went up to about the 10th floor. Me and Kurt Schork from Reuters, who was killed a few years later. And I slipped over and I cut myself on some broken glass, and that's, touch wood, the only time I've ever spilled my own blood. But it was, no, it's a very dangerous business. And safety is important, and it's great that we have the help that we have now, but there's no really safe way of doing it.
When I was foreign editor, I got quite worried that there were some people for whom, I suppose, war had become normality, really, and they kind of craved it. Were you one of those people?
Yeah, in a way, I was for a while. I'd say at that time, say the war in Grozny, which was the winter of 94-95, which was the first, when that first Grozny war started anyway, of the modern series. There'd been others previously. It was so felt so familiar to me to go off on a story, because I'd been in Bosnia, been in South Africa. That year, 94, I'd been in Bosnia, I'd been in Rwanda, I'd been in South Africa when there was a lot of violence in the townships, and here I was in Grozny, and I was seeing the same people all around. These were all my pals. You'd be in the middle of Grozny in the snow and terrible scenes, really terrifying stuff actually, and then you'd see a pal and it would be nice, you'd bump flak jackets and go on to your next job, and it did seem like normality to me. And looking back on it, that wasn't good, but if you send people constantly, if people go to stories like that the whole time, that's how they feel. I never was deranged about it. I think there were some people I knew who were. I knew people who had been multiply shot and would keep going back to do more and take horrendous risks, snappers especially, actually. And I was never like that, but just to be there itself, just to be there was very risky. Of course it was.
Okay, let's look at the next piece.
Next piece is the only good news story I've ever done, which was the inauguration of Nelson Mandela. And I went there in 94, Vin sent me down, actually, after our correspondent.
They gathered in front of the Union buildings, the place where apartheid was conceived and administered. The amphitheater in front was reserved for special guests from the governments that isolated this country for so long. Vice President Gore and Hillary Clinton represented the United States. Yasser Arafat, the PLO leader, was there, and Fidel Castro came from Cuba. Prince Philip led the British delegation. The elite of the new South Africa was invited, including Winnie Mandela, the estranged wife of the president, and their daughter. Down below, they waited and turned the lawns of the Union buildings into a people's park.
I wish the world could feel the way I feel. Peaceful, happy, hoping, eager for the best in life.
It's unbelievable. It's like a dream come true.
It's a great day in our lives. It means freedom for us. Freedom at last.
As state occasions go, it was getting very relaxed. Then, a few minutes after midday, Nelson Mandela arrived.
Yes, that's the moment. Yeah,
they moved quickly on to the solemn business of the day, the oath of office that finally installed Nelson Mandela as state president of South Africa.
I, Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela, do hereby swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa.
Will you please raise your right hand and say, so help me God.
So help me God.
What was good news about that was because no one expected it to go so smoothly. Everyone expected, all the journalists there, especially South Africans, expected violence. And the AP had a T-shirt made saying, South Africa elections 1994, take your protein pills and put your helmet on. And there, quite early on, in a few months before that, martial law had been declared in KwaZulu-Natal, where there's a lot of trouble, there's a lot of violence. And we all flew down from Johannesburg, and I went into the bar where everybody was staying, and all these, again, people used to trouble. A lot of the local press corps who had spent years covering township violence, they were really up for it. And there was real anticipation that, I mean, it was their own country falling to bits and they didn't like that, but as a story, they thought it was going to be a hell of a story, the Civil War. And it didn't happen. And everyone expected it to happen, not just journalists. And that was down to Mandela, because he made big concessions to Buthelezi, which staved it off. And he was fantastic. And as I say, it was the only time I've ever done a good news story. And it was entirely unexpected. That was a plus two. Then I went to Rwanda to do the genocide after that.
Let's move on to the next one.
Yeah. Next one is Rabin assassination, 1995. I just got a job as Middle East correspondent based in Jerusalem. And this happened a month or two. I was having real withdrawal symptoms from Bosnia. And this happened when I'd been there a couple of months, and I realized the Middle East was actually a strong story.
Yitzhak Rabin had spent the evening at a peace rally in Tel Aviv. The rally ended with Mr. Rabin joining in a song for peace. Police estimated around 100,000 people were there. One placard said, Yitzhak Rabin, you are the hero of our generation. The assassin opened fire as the rally was breaking up. Mr. Rabin's bodyguard threw himself in front of the bullets. He was hit as well.
When Rabin came down, he started walking towards the car from the stairs, from the flight of stairs. And I said to my girlfriend, this is bad security because there's only one exit. And he came down, he walked towards the car. All of a sudden, there were like four shots, five shots, something like that. And then he like collapsed. I saw him collapsing, and everybody, they just took us down.
Yitzhak Rabin was rushed to hospital. An emergency operation was attempted, but he died a little later. Police arrested a 27-year-old student who comes from a prosperous town north of Tel Aviv. Later, they said he was a known activist in Jewish extremist organizations. Crowds gathered outside the hospital. Right-wingers had threatened Yitzhak Rabin's life many times. Security around him had been threatened, but Mr. Rabin, a former general, always led from the front. He never hid himself away. There's great shock and very public emotion here. Outside the hospital, angry bystanders turned on a right-winger. This country was already deeply divided by the peace process Mr. Rabin had championed. There will be bitter recriminations as Israel enters a period of official mourning.
So I should say that that won the RTS award that year, didn't it, actually, for the breaking story, I think it was.
Well, because we did it in about 10 minutes. And it was an incredibly successful political assassination, because the guy who did it, who's still in prison and is a hero to some on the far right in Israel, wanted to destroy the peace process. And I think that act, as much as any other, you can argue some of the things Arafat did didn't help, but that act, as much as anything, because Rabin had an understanding with Arafat, and I think that he succeeded, because what he wanted to do was destroy the peace process, and that's what he did. And really, I think history would have been quite different if he had lived.
You were having some kind of dinner, I seem to remember, with other correspondents, weren't you?
We had, my partner and I had only been in Jerusalem for about a couple of months, and we finally thought we'd invite some people around to dinner, some people we knew. And I had actually imported specially some sausages from London, because I'd been back to London. And I had Delia Smith's sausage casserole recipe. I'm a more accomplished cook now, but it was 1995, I was learning to do these things. And I made it, I was quite proud of it. And then in the middle of the dinner, the phones all went, beepers, phones, everything, around the table, because they're all journalists, and everyone raced off. And my partner, too, is also a journalist, so we all raced off. I was a bit after the hour. I was after ITN because I, A, didn't have an iron shirt, and I had to shave. I had 2 days' growth, so that put me back by about 10 minutes. I was frantically ironing a shirt, thinking, I've got to be on air in 40 minutes. And we got back 2 days later, and Robert Moore of ITN's fork was still loaded with food. He hadn't even paused. Such a news hound. He hadn't even paused to put it in his mouth and finish it and chew it. Maybe it was a commentary on my cooking. I think it was more he wanted to get at it, up and at it. No, it was a huge story with enormous impact and a terrible tragedy, actually, for both sides there.
Did you, a lot of Middle East correspondents have kind of fallen out of Jerusalem eventually under a lot of stress because they found it a very tense place to work. Did you feel that about Jerusalem?
I lived there for five and a half years, and I absolutely hated it for the first two and a half, probably, or three, because it was so tense, it was so full of hatred. The story was fine. I mean, I liked the job, but I couldn't stand the people of either description, either side. I had a few friends, but, you know, mainly foreigners, frankly. But then something started growing on me. I read more about the story. I got to know Jerusalem. I got to know the Palestinian story and the struggle and the Israeli story and the Jewish history. And there were moments when, you know, I dread going back there from somewhere else. You know, you get the security and all that stuff. But then I get out of the airport and start driving up the hill from the airport in Tel Aviv towards Jerusalem. The sun would be going down and the light there is fabulous. And it suddenly grew on me, and I got to like it. And I think I went through the pain barrier. And I still go there the whole time, years later, in my current job. And I like it. I mean, I don't mind all the tension. But I agree, if I left after 2.5 years, I've left with awful thoughts about the place.
There's an interesting debate about the kind of Anglo-American way of sending in big hitters to stories from London. Versus people in Foreign Bureau who are working there locally. Now, you've done both, actually. I mean, do you think it's legitimate to send people in from London to a story when there are people based there on the ground?
Depends on the people. Depends how on the demand of the story, depends how well they can do it. If there's someone who's really good on the ground, then it's a shame if, you know, the phrase we use in the news business is if he's big-footed. I mean, I, for many years, had the imprint of John Simpson's size 12 brogue on the top of my head, and I still do occasionally, I think.
John used to call himself the dentist, didn't he? It's painful, but it won't last long.
Yes, isn't it? And it only happens once a year.
Yeah.
Yes, I know. I think now, as I have a job based in London, that, yes, it's absolutely fine to go and bigfoot everybody. But, you need both. You need both, I think. I go to London to a place where I lived in the region, and I spent quite a lot of time there, so I have a fair idea of what's going on. But I think to be sent in somewhere where you know nothing and to bigfoot someone who knows the story, that's a waste of time.
Okay, let's leave this piece.
Next thing, Kosovo, 1999. I was based in the Middle East, but I went back to former Yugoslavia. And this was after the NATO troops had gone in. I went in with the Germans in southern Kosovo.
Down a leafy lane where quiet people lived quiet lives, war has left waste, death, and hate. Serbs and Albanians were side by side in these hamlets. The Albanians say their Serb neighbors turned into their persecutors, their murderers. Now they've gone, they're looting and burning their houses.
There are scores to settle here, unfinished business to complete with people whose names they know before they can even start thinking about the future. No Albanian in this area is talking about reconciliation. What they want is revenge.
They're still searching the ruins, but they think in all 85 died here during the war. Life has come down to scavenging, mourning, burying, burning, remembering, and regretting. Mrs. Halili's two sons, grown men, were taken from her and shot dead. If only I'd been with them, I would have squashed those Serbs flat. She hardly noticed, too worried that she hadn't saved her children. Everybody here seems lost, wandering into what's left of their lives, certain only that if Serbs come back, they'll kill them. Jeremy Bowen, BBC News, Nakel, Kosovo.
I've always thought that's a fantastic piece of television journalism, Jeremy.
Thank you. Yeah. No, I'm still pleased with that one.
Tell us about the craft of television journalism and writing and the use of sound and... What makes fantastic television?
Well, that was two ends, really. There was a bit in the middle, I think, that cut out. It was a long piece. And we decided that we'd, me and the people I was working with, we decided that we would try and concentrate on one place. Because a lot of things seem to be going on. But because things like burnings and looting was happening the whole time, I thought that if we look at one place, really intensively, we'll just get a lot more value out of it in terms of getting closer to what's really going on. So I was also helped by working with one of the most fantastic cameramen in the world of TV news.
DC.
Nick Millard. Aussie, who I work with a lot, luckily, because it adds so much. The quality of his work adds so much to it. You can hear from the sound there, the shooting, the opening shot where there was a bird flying along. He was sitting on top of our armored Land Rover filming. He's a big tall guy, 6'7", so he was right up there. And he was saying, no, faster, go slow, a bit slower, and then he got the shot. And he pointed that out to me. He said, why don't we start with this shot? Because it's quite predictable in a war zone to start the piece with some kind of terrible scene of carnage. Why don't we start with a bird flying down a country lane? And then get into the horrors that lie beneath. So it was what we needed to do that piece was a lot of time. We spent about 3 days on it, and luckily we had time. We had great material because there was drama going on. But to get the drama, you had to be there and really spend a lot of time there. So every day we were there from dawn to dusk and beyond for 3 days. And it worked out, and then I had time with Nick to put it together. It was about 3.5 minutes, I think, the piece, maybe four, which is really long for TV news. And we spent all day cutting it. Sometimes you've got to slash it together in about no time at all. I mean, that Rabin piece, as I say, we did in 15 minutes. This thing, we spent all day doing it. And it worked out as a result.
But what are the qualities that if you were teaching a student now? I mean, you say it's 4 minutes long. It's probably what 2.5 minutes of script because of the amount of space and sound there is in there.
Well, let it breathe. I mean, the whole point about TV news, I think, and where TV news has an advantage over other media, is it gives you an idea. At its best, it can give you an idea of what it's like to be that person on that day in that place. And to get that idea, You have to get to know some of the characters, but as well as that, you need to, you have to feel it, you have to hear it. You have to almost, you know, if you can, through the sound and the sight, smell it. And the way you can do that, I think, is by, you've got to get into the whole texture of the thing, and that means you can't have wall-to-wall words. You have to have simple thoughts, but simple thoughts that mean something a bit deeper. And I think that the best kind of, if you're an expert on a site, newspapers tend to know who their audiences are. If you're writing about the Middle East for the FT, you know that the kind of people in general who read it are people who probably know something about it. If you're doing any sort of story for television news, you'll get the foreign secretary possibly watching it, or maybe his top officials, and you'll get people who just landed there by accident because they didn't turn over in time. And the idea is that you have to try and do something which will appeal to all of them. So I've always thought of it as like a cake, a layer cake. It has layers in it, layers of meaning and illusion. And so through simple scripting, you can hopefully at times, and most of the time doesn't work out, allude to things which maybe someone who gets more of the story and understands it will pick up, but therefore don't confuse those people who don't know anything about it at all. And at the same time, you have to try and explain complicated things in a way that won't put off the people who know it, and without talking down to the audience. So you must, someone said, maybe it's an old hackneyed phrase, but something like never underestimate people's intelligence, but never overestimate their knowledge. So you've got to pitch it right, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. I'm talking about what I do, and it applies to if you get the right day with the right story, the right material, the right cameraman, enough time to edit, to do a good job, you can do something really powerful. Mm. A lot of the rest of the time, unfortunately, a lot of the time it's a compromise.
I noticed that in several of those pieces you're using people's names as well, which I think is, it just brings it home to, it gives it a sense.
Yeah, you've got to make people, these are human beings. I mean, I've spent a lot of time in places where people are suffering, and sometimes they in some reporting they can come across as a sort of nameless horde of victims. And I've always thought that you should try and realize, in whatever country you're in, if people's kids get killed, they feel as bad as anyone else in this room would feel about it, even if they're poor or living in Africa. Really, it's true, they're the same as us. So and I think sometimes people don't quite realize that, and I think you have to make a point of that.
Okay, let's cast ahead a year to 23rd of May, year 2000, in Lebanon, and probably one of, if not the worst thing that happened to you in your career.
The worst day of my life.
Which was when your fixer, Abed, was killed. Tell us what happened on that day.
He was a Lebanese guy who'd worked for the BBC and for NBC and various others in Beirut for 25 years or more. And we went down, the Israelis were pulling out, ending an occupation that had lasted in different forms for 20 years or so, of South Lebanon. So we went down there. It was all happening very quickly, sooner than they'd said that they'd do it. They took everybody by surprise. I happened to be in Beirut on a holiday. So I didn't have any of the right gear, didn't have a flak jacket, didn't have anything. But I went down to the south the final day they were pulling out with Abed and a guy called Malik, who was our cameraman in Beirut. And we were basically following the Israelis out. They were leaving through one gate in the border wire. So it was like water going out of a bath. And the level of them was falling down. And as space was released by the Israelis leaving, Lebanese civilians who had been barred from the place in the main for a very long time were coming in. So we were really doing a story about the civilians. I didn't want to get near the soldiers because I knew it would be dangerous. But what I didn't take into account was the road there goes along the border wire, and while we were quite some way from the retreating soldiers, we were actually about 100 yards from Israel. And I didn't think that they'd fire over the wire, but they did. So we stopped to do a piece to camera. And I got out with Malik, and Abed stayed in the car because he was on the phone to his son. His whole family drove journalists around, and they had a bit of an empire. And a lot of people were coming in to do the story. And so he had people coming, he was doing his arrangements, and normally he wouldn't stay in the car because he felt it was a target. And I'd been out for about 3 minutes. He'd set up the camera. I was standing there trying to think of something to say. In fact, the camera wasn't running at that moment. He just ran it when it happened, when the bang happened. And anyway, and I heard a bang behind me. I turned around. My first thought was, I hope the camera's running, so we got that, so we got the noise. My next thought was, the whole side of the hill's on fire. And this is in a nanosecond. And my next thing was, I saw Abed pushing himself out of the car, out of the window, on fire. And so I said to Malik, I said, we've got to get up there. Let's go. And he said, don't go, don't move. Take cover. I said, what? He said, look, Abed's dead. A tank shell hit the car. He can't have survived that. He's dead. If you go up there, they'll kill you with a machine gun. Or they'll kill you. They'll have a go at you. And afterwards, I heard someone who'd been on the other side saying he'd overheard the radio traffic from a commander, and it had said, we've got one of them, we'll get the other two with a machine gun. So I know that if I'd gone up there, they'd have opened fire with a 50 caliber machine gun on the tank. And they were only a kilometer and a half away, we found out later. And so I know they'd have killed me. But I still feel bad about not going up there. I still feel bad about it. Because had we not stopped there, had I not decided to do a piece to camera there, he'd probably not have been killed. Obviously, the Israelis killed him, but I was certainly complicit in that or involved in that, you know. So the next day, he was buried in Beirut, and I went back to work. The day after that, because I thought, well, I don't want to go back to Israel just now, where I was living. And then when I was back in the down in the south, someone came up to me and said, you know, terrible news. We thought you were dead for a while, Jeremy, and then Abed, and then of course there was Miguel and Kurt, Kurt Schork and Miguel Gill, who are two friends of mine from Sarajevo, were killed the day of Abed's funeral. In an ambush in Sierra Leone. And when two other guys I knew as well were quite badly wounded and had to hide in the bush for hours and hours while the people rampaged around trying to find them. So, you know, that's when I started realizing that it's a numbers game, that here were three people I knew well, friends of mine, killed in 2 days in two separate wars on two separate continents. And so I'd already actually decided to take the offer to be a presenter. But I remember I was looking at his car burning and not being able to get up there, because when I finally, after about 10 minutes, tried to walk up, they opened fire with a machine gun. So I thought then I've done the right thing in pulling away from this, because just by the law of averages, I thought to myself, if you continue with this job, you're going to get hurt. And my partner was running our operation in South Lebanon, and she was pregnant with our first kid. And you know, they thought for 2 hours or so that I was dead, because I had an erroneous report that I was. So you know, I thought this is just time for something else.
Did you? Was that influential in your decision not to go to Baghdad that second time? When
it was completely. Yeah, in Baghdad in 2003, the BBC asked me if I wanted to go to do what I'd done in 1991. And initially I said yes, and I was just coming, I had to stop being a presenter. And this would have been a brilliant way back into reporting. And in 1991, when they asked me, it took a nanosecond. And I said yes when they asked me to go in 2003. And then I felt sick. I thought I was going to throw up. And after agonizing, for a week or more, I rang up the foreign editor and I said, look, I'm sorry, I just cannot do this. I can't do it. I kept having a dream. I told the cameraman in Kherson afterwards, actually, who was already there. I kept having a dream of burying this guy in a shallow grave next to the Rashid Hotel. I told him afterwards he didn't think it was at all funny. If the same thing happened now, I don't know if I'd be quite the same, but at that particular, the way my mindset was, I just thought, I'm not going to do this. I don't have it in me anymore. I've had too many close calls.
I think I'm right in saying you were pretty open at the time about having counselling.
After Abed was killed, I did, because I'd been in all kinds of situations in the past where I had close calls, people I'd known had been killed, but this one was more personal. And I started having, quite quickly, I started having bad dreams and starting at sudden noises and things like that. So a colleague who I didn't really know very well, in fact, came up to me and she said, look, but she knew what had happened. She was also in Lebanon. And she came up to me a couple of days afterwards and said she'd been in Nicaragua in a car that was ambushed and everybody else in the car except her was killed, journalists. And so she said, look, they completely fucked me up for years. And you've got to go and sort yourself out and see someone. So I did. And it sorted me out. And while these things, you know, you're never the same person afterwards, it's, I'm certainly not, it's all under control.
I think it was an important moment, actually, because you admitted to it. A lot of other correspondents felt that it was an okay thing to do, whereas they had worried that it was a kind of sign of weakness beforehand, you know.
Well, that was major one reason why I decided to come out with it, as it were, because I'd seen myself as I felt that my macho credentials were not in question. You know, I'd done a lot of tough things. And so I thought, well, if I can say it, anyone can say it. So that's part of the reason why I did say it, actually.
You mentioned your kids there. Did they have an effect on the way you operate or your journalism, as it were, besides not going to places?
Yeah, I mean, of course. I mean, now, with my job as Middle East editor, I have, you know, I try not to go to dangerous places, as I say, because I don't want to get hurt. And I've got many reasons not to get hurt. But whereas when I was single, without kids, I don't think I had so many reasons. But no, because they change the way you perceive stories. You know, I could do pieces about the sense of loss a parent may feel if their kids were killed in former Yugoslavia. But it was more of a mental understanding of how they'd feel rather than the gut feeling of how they'd feel. Because now, of course, I've got the gut feeling. Because I have two small kids of my own. And when I was in, my emotions are very skin deep as a result of that. And when I was in Gaza, we're going to show shortly a clip from a panorama I did in Gaza in earlier on this year, after the Israelis opened the gates and let us in, belatedly. And that was really tough, doing that, because you know, it was all about the way that people had suffered. And this was a place, Gaza, I knew pretty well. And seeing what people had gone through was, you know, it was, of course, I empathized enormously with the people there. Who couldn't? You'd be made of stone not to, but because I was a parent myself, it's much deeper, you feel it more deeply.
Okay, let's crack on with these last two clips and then we'll have some questions.
Yeah, well, the first one before the last but one is John Simpson in Kabul. The famous event when John Simpson captured Kabul fell down. Now, the thing is...
Liberated, right?
Liberated. The thing is, he did a brilliant piece of journalism, and that phrase, though... Anyway.
It was just before dawn that the wild dash for Kabul developed, thousands of soldiers intent on capturing the capital. It seemed to take no time at all to cover the 12 or so miles. As we drew nearer to Kabul, the grim evidence of battle. These were former supporters of the Northern Alliance who'd switched sides and joined the Taliban. No mercy for them. Then we saw they'd captured another man. The presence of our camera probably saved his life. He was paralyzed with terror. By now, there were no Taliban left to resist. Then came the critical moment. Would the Northern Alliance simply race on and pour into Kabul itself, even though they'd undertaken not to? The commander in charge was determined not to let it happen. He ordered the armored vehicles to block the way. The great advance was stopped in its tracks. But Kabul lay temptingly close to us now. A small BBC team decided to head on into the city alone. We went on foot so no one would think we were soldiers. We plowed on down the hill. At this stage, there are only a few local people around us.
Well, this is it. We're walking into Kabul city. We don't seem to have any problems around us. There's only people that are friendly and are saying, chanting, I'm afraid, kill the Taliban. But we, as we understand it, as we walk in here, there aren't going to be that many Taliban anyway.
It was 7:53 a.m. local time. Kabul was a free city after 5 years of perhaps the most extreme religious system anywhere on earth. And if all that's finished now, so is the system which intruded so brutally in everyone's lives. Suddenly you don't have to wear a beard anymore if you don't want to. Shaving is a way of demonstrating your liberation. So is showing your face in public if you're a woman. And there's one thing more. Children can fly kites again. Freedom's in the air here. John Simpson, BBC News, Kabul.
I saw that. I was a presenter at the time. And, you know, everyone giggled a bit then, because you knew the line was maybe coming about the BBC liberating Kabul, which was, unfortunately said that, because it detracted from what actually was a fantastic piece of television journalism. I sat and I watched it and I was just wowed by it. That was the beginning and the end of the piece. And that last line too, freedom's in the air. I mean, don't forget that he put that together working under the most incredible pressure. He'd been on the road trying to get in for about 2 months. Mm. It was the culmination of all of that. He'd physically gone in there. And then he had to sit down with a great pile of tapes, and he probably had, the time is on your side, the time difference is on your side, so he had a few hours, but to come up with a great script, to put the pictures together that well, I'm telling you, that is not easy, that is really hard. Even the piece to camera there, when he was going along, I don't know if you noticed at one point he pushes a kid away. Because it is a real pain, frankly, people in those. So, and you don't get that many chances to do your stand-up, and clearly thought, this is my chance. And he had the words, you tend to work out roughly what you're going to say, because even when it seems like you've just made it up, really you haven't, very rarely, certainly not in my case, I always think a bit in advance. And then you're in full flow and some little nipper tries to push him back. So it worked for me. I thought it was one of the best pieces of TV reporting I've ever seen.
I was really interested you chose that because Martin Bell told me that he thought that was the best piece he'd ever seen. Actually.
Really? Oh, well, there you go. That's,
you're in good company. Yeah. Okay, let's do the last piece.
Last piece, as I said, we did Panorama in Gaza. Really frustrating not being able to get in there this in December and January. Really frustrating because the Israelis wouldn't let us, but when the doors opened, even then it was hard to get in. We had to go in via Egypt, and it was touch and go, but we got in. And then in a very quick turnaround, about a week, a bit more than a week, I did a film for Panorama. And the bit that we'd chosen is a bit in the... There was a doctor who had done a lot for connections with Israel. He worked in Israel. And he had... his kids had been in Gaza. And they'd been his daughters, and they'd been studying in their room when it was hit by an Israeli tank shell. And we went into the house, and you could still see everything. And that's what I tried to put over. There were two explosions within a minute of each other. Dr. Izzadine and his brother Abu Ahmed came rushing in here. It's where their daughters were. Bissan, the eldest of Dr. Izzadine's daughters, was lying here. They lifted her out, but she died on the way into the next room. Gaida was there in the corner. They thought she was dead. Here in the center of the room, the girls had been working at computers. In this corner, there was Maya. Her head was blown off by the blast. Bits of her brain are still on the wall and on the ceiling as well. You can imagine the force of the explosion. Aya was lying here. She was dead. And this corner was a little work area. Noor was here, dead as well. Her head blown off as well. It's a typical teenage girl's room. One of the terrible ironies of this, of course, is the fact that this was the family and this was the home of a Palestinian who had spent a large part of his life working for peace with Israel.
Incredibly powerful. I've got one more question for you, Jeremy, and then we'll open it out to others. But it's just really about your current job, actually, as Middle East editor, which is why you get to go out and do these kinds of pieces. I very much doubt whether there's any single journalist in the UK who has their work as closely scrutinised as you do in this role. What is that like?
I try not to think about it too much, to be honest with you. I just go ahead with what I do, and I don't second-guess the complainants. Well, I do in a way, because I know what they're going to get worked up about. And sometimes that gives me a certain satisfaction, and sometimes I write, sometimes I deliberately put things in which I know will spike their guns in terms of, you know, do a few lines, I think they're about to complain about this, and then I put in the thing which, so I try and lead them up the garden path a bit, and then, no, but in a serious way, I would say that because I work for the BBC and because of the, where we are, the network that we are, the broadcasting organization that we are, we will get a lot of attention. And we broadcast globally, and you have to expect it. So it doesn't really worry me too much. I mean, I had an unfortunate experience with the BBC Trust where they found me guilty on one or two cases of lack of impartiality or something, and which I felt was the wrong decision. I still feel it's the wrong decision, but it's up to them to make it if they want to. So I put these things behind me. And it does mean, I think, if you work in the Middle East, because of the scrutiny, you really have to be very careful that what you don't have, you cannot write a word lightly. You have to know that what you write is defensible, because you know that if it's not defensible, there'll be some person from either side of the equation, actually, who will pick you up on it and will try and take it to the nth degree in terms of, you know, getting me sacked or blackening my name somewhere. A lot of weird stuff happening in the blogosphere sometimes. And the only way to deal with it is not to worry about it. I just try and do good journalism.
Okay. Let's go to questions now. Two rules. You've got to have the microphone. Okay. And secondly, only one question each. Okay. Steve, do you want to go first?
Hello, Jeremy. Steve Pearce, BBC. I'm very interested you moved away from journalism and presented two programmes, one on Moses and Noah. I wondered how you got into that and how that all came about. I'm interested.
Well, that was some biblical stuff. They asked me to do that when I was still living in Jerusalem. It was a nice diversion for a while. They were big so-called landmark documentaries on BBC One, and it was a different sort of thing, going to do big money, big budget, religious historical programs with extras and costumes. I wasn't in costume, but you know, and it was a nice challenge, you know, doing pieces to camera with having to coordinate what I say and what I did and where I walked with 100 extras, that sort of thing. It was a nice challenge.
Okay, who's next? The guy with the glasses at the back there.
Do you feel that when people see scenes of a massacre or some attack on civilians, they naturally feel that the other side have to be the bad side? And, you know, how does that affect your reporting in terms of what you cover and how you describe it?
Well, if it's a massacre, as in willful killing of a group of innocents, then the other side are baddies, even if they're not bad most of the time. They're bad at least when that moment happened. No, I'm very aware of the power of pictures. And I'm very aware of the way in which pictures can be presented and manipulated. Even if it's down to a small thing, for example, I remember once in Kabul in the late 80s, the only strong picture we had all day was of a tank, an old tank maneuvering, but it was nicely shot and it looked almost like an armored regiment on the move, but it was the only tank moving in Kabul that day. And I had a real crisis of conscience about not opening with it. Luckily, I didn't in the end, or I wouldn't be telling the story. But I could have made it look like the whole place was about to catch on fire when it wasn't. So, you know, you can manipulate pictures and meanings and things like that, and you just have to realize that it's not in your interest long-term as a reporter to do that, because people tend to find out, and once they've rumbled you as somebody who either manipulates things or doesn't tell the whole truth and the unvarnished truth and the good things about the baddies and the bad things about the goodies, then you've lost it. You know, you don't have any credibility at that point.
Thank you, Jeremy. Bari Alameddin, a fellow journalist. That was really very interesting and enlightening. I want to ask, of course, about your reporting of Gaza and Palestine and the Israeli. I want to know about the scrutiny the challenge that you get all the time. Does it affect the quality of your reporting at the end of the day? Because I felt when you were reporting on Gaza, you were not really 100% yourself. Maybe you were 98, but not 100%.
Pulling a few punches.
Thank you. I really thought so. So I want you to...
Yeah, it's interesting to say that. You see, I think that... I'll argue now something against myself. I mean, was the fact that the Israelis closed the doors to us of Gaza, we couldn't get in, was the fact that we were therefore on their side, did that slant the reporting that we did? I think that had I got into Gaza, what I would have done would have been much more powerful in terms of the story. We knew what was happening in there. Pictures were getting out, because the news agencies were feeding out pictures, and plus we had our own excellent Palestinian staff there who were pushing stuff out themselves and doing a little bit of reporting. But it meant, I think, that because I was working with agency material, and you know, Vin made the point that I was trying to put names in of people and that sort of thing, it's very difficult doing. If it had any sense of slight distance, it was because I was a bit distant. I wasn't there. And I think it's a real argument for the fact that to do a really good job, you have to be there. Because how can you be, I said earlier on that the whole point about being a TV reporter is giving people a feel of what it's like to be there that day. But actually, if you're not there that day yourself, it's very hard to give that feel. So I think that if you look at my scripts, I think they were fair, and we put them in the strongest pictures that we could. But it would be nothing like being there. Mm. You know, to be in the Shifa hospital in Gaza at the moment when wounded people were coming in and doing a piece about that, I'm telling you, we would have done something very, very powerful. But we couldn't. Or to be on the streets, we couldn't do it because we weren't there. And that was why the Israelis didn't let people in. So we couldn't do that.
Okay, on the back.
Hi, Jeremy. Apologies for walking out a bit earlier. Was having a bit of a flashback. I just wanted to ask you, you were saying that you had some therapy. I was actually in New York on September 11th and was injured. And I just wondered how you've dealt before you went into therapy with the things you've seen and heard and smelt, as you so vividly told us earlier.
Well, for lots of years, I think I dealt with it pretty well. You know, I'd spend days and days and weeks in Bosnia where we'd have terrible days with dead people and close calls and taking wounded people to hospital sometimes and, you know, hard stuff. And then essentially with my, I was, you know, as I said, I was quite young and I was quite indestructible feeling it anyway, and I got quite close to the guys I was working with, and we'd get drunk every evening, essentially, is how we'd deal with it. We'd go and we'd get completely smashed most nights and have a raucous time. And then we'd go out the next morning, a little hungover the first hour or two, and do the job. I mean, we were younger then, so we didn't have such bad hangovers. I couldn't possibly do it like that now. Martin Bell used to go to bed at 7 in the evening, you know, and I never got that, but now I completely get it. I completely get it. Why, you just, you'd write a nice supper, cup of tea, go to bed early night. It's a, I see younger chaps now. Forget it. I just couldn't do it now. But then I could. So there was a bit of self-medication going on, as it were, and also the fact that you were with people who'd done the same thing all that day. They understood what was going on. It's not like you talk it through or anything, but you might tell a few stories about what happened in the course of the day. And it worked fine. It was just that when my friend Abed Takkoush got killed in Lebanon, because I felt more than partially responsible for his death, because I decided to stop, and that's always going to be something I have to have with me, it was more personal. That was the thing. It was much more personal, and that's what I think struck a chord, and not a good chord with me.
Okay, I'm told we're very short for time, so two more questions if we can. There's one there, and then the final one at the front here.
You mentioned the restrictions in Gaza, and we've also seen journalists being restricted in places such as Sri Lanka and recently your ports from Iran. How has this affected the role of the conventional broadcast journalist, and are these kind of restrictions going to become commonplace, do you think, in the future?
Yes, I'm sure they will become commonplace because people see that they're effective in a way. The Sri Lanka story has been not nearly covered in the way that it would have been if people had been allowed to get there. I was up there at the time of the tsunami, and I would love to go back there, even though it's not my area anymore, and report on what's happening, but it's impossible, except under very regulated circumstances. And the Israelis can't regulate what you do when you're inside Gaza, but they were able to stop us going into Gaza. Humanitarian groups, the ICRC and so on, UNHCR, talk about the humanitarian space decreasing, the space in which they can work in emergencies decreasing. And in a way, journalists occupied part of that space as well. And when I started, journalists still got killed and hurt, but I think in many places it was possible to be recognized as a non-combatant. That's absolutely not the case now. They always think that you're biased in someone's favor and that what you do might help, and wherever you are. And that's partly, I think that's mainly a result of the way that the world is now wired together. And there's instant communication. So people know that the media war is terribly important, and when getting your message on the screen is terribly important. And even if your message is, we're here, we're in a very important group, even if there are four of you, they're knocking off somebody, maybe a reporter, if that's the only person you see, any foreigner you see around the place, will get you onto the international news cycle that day. So I think that the way the world is now, we're tightly wired. I think the way that people are now wiser to the media in terms of knowing the power of pictures, I think that all that means it is much, much harder to work, and it's more dangerous. There are many more no-go areas, or go with great caution areas around the world and stories than there were when I started doing this about 25 years ago.
Okay, last question.
Jeremy, as well as you know the Israelis and the situation with Iran, would you comment on the likelihood or not of them attacking Iran?
The Israelis are quite open about the fact that if they thought Iran was about to get a nuclear weapon, and no one else was going to do anything about it, they'd attack them. And I believe them when they say that. I think that the Israelis have been trying to internationalize. I think it's a really serious crisis facing the world at the moment, actually. I'm going to Geneva tomorrow for the talks that are going on there, the talks between the Security Council permanent members, Germany, and the Iranians. And I think that the Israelis would like to internationalize it. They would like Iran to be bombed. The government would definitely like Iran to be bombed. They want the Americans to do it, because the Americans could do it much more effectively than they could. And also it gives them a greater degree of diplomatic protection. I think that the problem with the current diplomatic process is it's a diplomatic process which is backed by the use of force. And the thing about it is, if that diplomatic process doesn't work, and you talk to diplomats involved in it, and they'll tell you now that it's looking very hollow. And if they don't get results by spring next year, I would say that then they then have a choice. Do they go through with their threat to use force? Or do they say, all right, when we said we'd use force, we didn't mean it? the Americans might say that, then the Israelis might do something. So I think that it's very dangerous. I think there's if Iran continues to enrich and they can't do a deal, and there are formulations which are around which might be a deal, and maybe that's, hopefully that's what they'll talk about tomorrow, the day after tomorrow, rather. If they can't, the chances of some kind of war are, they're there, definitely. It's possible. It's possible.
Well, that's a nice light note.
Yes, up there. This is my life.
Okay, I'd like to thank David Hayward and the team from the college for producing the session. Julie and everyone at the Frontline Club as well. To you for your questions. I got one last question for Jeremy, actually. Your dad was a journalist. You're a journalist.
I know what's coming.
One of your kids comes to you at the age of 18 and says, Dad, I want to be a journalist. What do you say?
Well, until a year ago, I'd have said, no, be a hedge fund guide, because you'll make some serious money. I couldn't say no, could I? I'd probably say, be a sports correspondent. No, I wouldn't even say that. I'd say, fine, do it, but go into it with your eyes open and realize that I'm sure they won't do it. I'd be worried if they did.
Jeremy, you've been a fantastic guest, Jeremy.